But I never seemed to find a place where I really felt welcomed. I struggled with my identity and felt like I was just kind of going through the motions every day. On the weekends, my parents would ask me, is there anyone that you want to have over? And I was kind of getting nervous that they would catch up, but I was like, oh yeah, no, I don't want to invite anyone over. So if I had a bunch of activities going on, they wouldn't ask me. So I just started like joining more activities, so they were like, where are your friends? when COVID hit, I kind of just stopped like communicating with people. It was really hard because I didn't have my activities anymore, and I just became more anxious. My family kind of caught on that I wasn't really leaving my bed just because there wasn't anything for me to do. And so we got my dog, and so Poppy helped me because she got me out of the house. I finally had something bring me joy. But I still didn't feel like I really had a purpose, and I felt in my soul that something was missing. At this point, I was starting to question my faith more, and my anxiety was just growing knowing that I had to go back to school. Later on that year, I started going to therapy, but over the months, it just didn't feel like things were getting better. After a rough week, I was at church on Wednesday, and there happened to be a prayer room. I went in the prayer room, and a lady that I'd never met before prayed for me. I didn't know her, she didn't know me, but what she was saying was exactly what I needed to hear. God was talking to me through her. In that moment, my questions were answered, and God told me to put my trust in him. I was struggling with the feeling of judgment from others, but God reminded me that his view of me is the only one that matters, and he loves me unconditionally. After that encounter, I was starting to grow in identity, but I was still struggling with not having a community that I felt like I could fall back on. Going to school, I felt like an outsider, and all my church friends were too far away to visit. I was involved, again, with a lot of things and interacted with a bunch of people. So when it came time for my grad party, I handed out a bunch of grad advice. I was like, oh my gosh, like so many people are going to be here. Anyway, and so the party finally came, and only four girls from my entire grade, and mind you, I had a class of 650, so to only have four girls from my grade show up really hurt. People passed through, but all I could focus on was that I was like, I thought I did so much. How come there's not more people here? During the party, I had a former teammate of mine come up to me, and she's like, oh my gosh, Dana, it's like, you have a lot of people here. And I was like, what do you mean? That was the first time that I really scanned the party, and I looked around, and I was like, wow, I do have a lot of people here. And I was looking at the faces, everyone had one thing in common. They're all from church. And I was like, that was the first moment that I was like, I do have a community. This is my community. People came from all over, not just from Des Moines, from Lamoni, from all over. Some of them I didn't even know. Andre showed up. I'd never met Andre before. He was like, oh, hi. I was like, hi. It was in that moment that I knew that I did have a community and that God had been calling me to open my eyes all along. It would have been easy for me to ignore God's calls to serve him, but because I didn't, I was open to a peaceful kingdom and given a family that will love me unconditionally. Previously, I was serving my gifts to the world in hopes that it would accept me. Now I know that God accepts me just as I am, and in serving him, I'm widening his kingdom of heaven.
Thank you.
theme today was whom will you serve. I wasn't quite sure what I was going to talk about, but the one thing that did come to mind was to talk about the people I plan on serving through my career that I plan on having after my time at Graceland. So I think we all can relate that growing up, everyone would ask us the big question of, what do you want to be when you grow up? As kids, we have those outlandish, crazy answers of, I want to be an astronaut, or I want to be a vet, or a chef, or something like that. Little me always had the answer of, I wanted to be a mom, or a physical therapist, or I wanted to own my own dance studio as a child. I'm not doing that anymore, if you guys wanted to know. But once I got into high school, lucky for me, my dad was our guidance counselor, so he would have us take a bunch of different career tests to figure out, you know, what we possibly wanted to do after our time in college. So with those, based on what you answered and stuff like that, they would give you a preferred field or something they thought, you know, based off of your answers you would want to go into. So for me, my results were always either the field of psychology or the field of education. So all growing up, these kind of made sense to me because I have always been a people person. I always knew I could never have a job where I just sat at a desk and was never able to interact with people. I knew that my passion was to help people and do something with a job like that. I knew I had to constantly interact with people, otherwise I would go literally insane. So once my senior year of high school hit, on the way home from my very last volleyball game, which not really perfect timing, but my dad and I had the conversation of what my future would look like. So I basically told him, Dad, I want to be just like you when I grew up. I knew I wanted to work in a school and help kids, so after a lot of talking, we decided that I was going to major in elementary education and have a minor in psychology wherever I planned on going to school. My second semester of my senior year, after I figured out that this was what I wanted to do, I was able to go into some of my elementary schools at my high school, and also during my first semester of my freshman year here at Graceland, I was also able to go observe some schools, which, you know, helped me figure out that this is what I wanted to do, but it really didn't hit me until this summer with the job I had. So I'm originally from Woodbine, Iowa. Some of you may know where that is, some of you may not, but it's a small little town in western Iowa. So after my senior year of high school, my parents moved down to Grand Valley, Missouri. So for me, I grew up in Woodbine my whole life, so it's kind of a little bit of a culture shock for me. If you ask anyone who knows me, you would know that it was a pretty traumatizing time in my life. But that summer, I had to obviously find a job. This past summer was the first summer that I spent in Grand Valley, so I had to find a job. And in a small town like Woodbine, you really only have three options of work. You could either work at the pool, in the restaurant town, or you could be a nanny. For me, knew I couldn't work in a restaurant, could not do that. I'm not a very good swimmer, so pool wasn't going to work out very well for me either. So I chose to be a nanny. Obviously, this was a way I also found out that I loved kids and loved being with kids. So obviously, that's the only job experience I had. So when we moved down to Green Valley this summer, I was really stressed about what I was going to possibly do. But lucky for me, one of my friends hooked me up with a job at WeCare in Lee Summit, Missouri, which I'm very thankful that she was able to help me get that job. So kind of to describe like what WeCare is to you guys, I like to describe it as vacation Bible school, but like times 100. So rather than it just being like a week or two long, it's all summer long. So for what I did for my job, I was able to work with kids ranging from going into kindergarten to going into eighth grade. And I would take them swimming, going on field trips, bowling, and then the kids would have different classes every day, so like a Bible study class, or cooking, or arts and crafts and stuff like that. So I was able to actually run my own classroom, which was really cool. So this was probably the best experience I've ever had in my entire life. It was really what solidified that this is 100% what I want to do with my life, which was really cool. So something that really also helped me was, if you guys know, like living in a small town, my high school and my school, we didn't have much of diversity at all. So being able to work with bigger schools and stuff like that, I was able to get that experience. But I had one amazing experience in particular. I had a little girl who was in my going into first grade classroom, and she has very high functioning autism. So for me, I've experienced people with autism in my life, but I've never been in the shoes of being like their instructor. So this experience was very eye-opening to me. I would be lying to you if I didn't say that this summer there were times where it was a struggle with her, because WeCare was kind of like a trial run for her to see if
she was able to, you know, interact with other kids that were outside of her school or outside of her family. But by the end of the summer, she had grown so much into such an amazing little girl. So not only did I feel like I made an impact in her life, but I feel like she made an even greater one in mine. She showed me that because of the impact I was able to make on her life, that this is truly what I wanted to do. She showed me that each kid is different and unique in their own way, which makes this experience even more worthwhile for me. So I guess after that whole ramble about what I want to do with my life in my summer, I guess kind of the meaning behind my story is that God works in very mysterious ways. I thought the summer was going to be horrible. I was very nervous about not living in the same hometown that I lived in my whole life. And I was worried that I wouldn't be able to find a job or I wouldn't like my job that I had. But God put me in the situation because he knew that that's where I needed to be. At the beginning, I said I wanted to talk about who I would serve after college. And not only is the answer to that obviously the kids that I want to help, but it's also God. I know that in me pursuing this life after college, I'll be serving him because this is the plan he had for me all along. I just didn't know it yet. Thank you.
Speaking, but I feel like that's a good story, can relate it to a lot of different things, but obviously serving 5,000 people, the fish and the bread and all that stuff. Very obvious example. But there are different ways to serve. You can serve because you have to, because you want to, or because it's the right thing to do. Like when you're little and you're asked to carry the offertory baskets, that's serving. Unlocking the church for everyone before they show up, that's serving. Getting donuts for the band while they're practicing, that's definitely serving. Those are good. I think serving is the act of consciously putting your own needs and wants aside so you can put the needs and wants of others first. So, who can you serve? This summer, Nico over here and I had a fun job, you could say, where we took a bunch of little smelly middle school kids to DC. We would drive to their school and pick them up at like 2 in the morning and fly out to DC and just kind of make sure they didn't get lost or run over by a big bus. So you can say that, sir. Oh, Kenley did it too. I forgot. She was there. That was fun to go to. I'm also House President this year. I think that's definitely a way I can serve. So is Nico, so is Shane. You can ask them after the service and myself, but there's a lot of different ways serving being House President. A lot of it is fun, but still serving nonetheless, like planning out House functions, House meetings, making and designing shirts and apparel, and you know, I submitted mine 2 months ago and we still haven't gotten them, but it's okay. Nico made sure so I got one. Serving. But there are hard things too, like trying to get people out of their rooms to come out and hang out and do fun things. Sometimes people just don't want to do anything. Taking care of people when they've had a little too much fun on the weekends. It's not a good time for us, but still we do it because it's what we have to do, because it's the right thing to do. Talking to people when they're feeling down and sad and homesick, it can be hard, which leads me to my last point. It's important to serve others in your community, in your homes, in your lives, but we also can't forget that it's important to serve yourself as well. And I want to lead everyone here with a challenge today. Throughout the rest of the day, I want you to see if you can serve yourself 3 times. It can just be like a compliment to yourself, like, hey, I look pretty good today, or I didn't speed on my way to church. You know, easy things can be something like buying a new pair of shoes or having an extra cookie with dinner. Just, you know, don't take out of control, but like, you know, make an effort to be kind to yourself. Something that I strongly believe in is that if you can love yourself or serve yourself, how will you be able to show that to other people? So try and go out there and serve others, but also don't forget to serve yourself as well. So I'm supposed to say, for our last hymn, there's a lot of instruments, so make sure we start singing when the group of singers starts singing. Thank you.
need.